Consider a following problem. You have n points on the plane and you need to find overall pairwise distance between them. Sounds quite easy, right? Yeah, this is a problem from one of the stages of the most prestigious competitive programming competition, ICPC. ICPC is an annual programming competition in which teams of 3 people try to solve as many algorithmic problems as possible in 5 hours. In order to participate in the final stage, a team has to show good results at 2 to 3 preliminary stages. So, what could be the issue? We could just go through all the pairs of points, calculate the distance between them using a simple formula, and return sum. At small n, the program works instantaneously, but already at n being 50,000, the program does not fit into the time limit of 2 seconds for code execution. And at n being 500,000, the program runs for about 13 minutes, which indicates that this solution cannot be optimized by simple ways. It's quite easy to realize that the most time-consuming part of the code is this double loop. In it, we iterate over all n segments between our points. There are n choose 2 such segments. N choose 2 means the number of ways to take 2 elements from a set consisting of n elements. And it has quite an easy formula. We could just take first element in n ways, second in n minus 1, but since we don't want to distinguish pairs like 1, 2, and 2, 1, we have to divide it by 2. So it can be represented in the following form, which is the big O of n squared in terms of asymptotic rows. This means that the number of operations in our current program grows proportionally to the square of n. It can be easily seen by plotting the running time on the graph. It's clear that these points are well approximated by a parabola runtime equals n squared with a certain coefficient. Apparently, we need to come up with a solution where we don't need to traverse all edges to get the final result. Let's recall the problem statement and note that we need to return an answer with suspiciously low precision, just 1%. Usually, geometry problems require a relative error of 10 to the minus 6, so such a non-standard number cannot be random. The first idea that comes to mind when thinking about such low precision is to try statistical approach. We can try to assume that the lengths of the edges lie in a more or less reasonable distribution, and take lots of random edges up to the time limit and estimate the total distance using the average distance we can calculate from the selected edges. Let's try this method on some distributions. For example, let both coordinates lie in the standard normal distribution. Let's take 5000 edges and see what the error will be using this idea. In the code itself, we can choose at least 1 million edges, so in the end, the error will be even smaller. We can see that the error is quite small. This can be explained by the central limit theorem and the fact that we've chosen a distribution with quite small variance. The length of edges in such a structure will lie in the Rayleigh distribution with variance 8 minus 2 pi. Meanwhile, let's try this method on random points in the square. Everything is good here too. Well, let's try to implement the solution and submit it. The solution got the wrong answer on test 16. So, what's the problem? We have assumed a reasonable distribution, and the authors of the problem have obviously put something more interesting to the tests. It won't be very hard to come up with a counterexample to the current solution. Let's just imagine one very distant point from a group of 199,999 points that are very close. Then almost all of the resulting distance will come from very distant pairs of points, even though there are relatively few of them. And for the average distances and the estimation and the initial structure to be close, the number of randomly selected sational edges must lie within a very certain range. And our randomized solution might get unlucky, and we may choose either too many sational edges or too few. For instance, if we were to take 5 million edges, we would have to get exactly 20 long edges to get a result with 1% precision. It would be interesting to think about trying the current solution to get around this problem. But in new randomized solutions, we may encounter new problems to which there will be new tests. Let's try to think in the direction of non-randomized solutions, where we can say with certainty that the final precision will be good enough. Let's digress a little from the original problem and talk in general what the distance on the plane is. The distance between the points is defined by the given norm on vectors on the plane. A vector will be easiest to think of as a line segment on the plane that starts at the origin. Then, any vector will start at 0, 0 and end at some point xy. For example, the standard Euclidean norm, which induces Euclidean distance, is defined as the square root of x squared plus y squared. Let's take a look at the ends of the vectors with Euclidean norm 1, which is the same as the point's Euclidean distance 1 away from 0, 0. As expected, we get the standard union circle. But what could we call a norm of a vector? What properties a function must have to be a norm at all? The norm must be a function from the set of vectors into real non-negative numbers. This is definitely logical. The norm is in some sense the distance from 0 to a particular point, and we don't want to have a negative distance or, for example, an infinite distance for a certain point. Then, triangle inequality. That is, you cannot choose three vectors such that the direct distance between the origin and the point is greater than the sum of the norms of the two vectors that will sum to the same point. Also definitely sensible. The norm, in some way, must estimate the minimal travel time from 0 to some point.
Правда, absolute homogeneity. That is, multiplication of a vector by a constant changes its norm according to its absolute value.
This is also logical. We want all vectors along one line to have continuous norm. And it would be good if the sum of two identical vectors would give doubled norm.
For this, we need homogeneity. Absolute homogeneity has to be used to satisfy the first property that the function is non-negative.
And lastly, if the norm of a vector is zero, then the vector ends in the origin. We don't really want to have zero distance between two distinct points. You can see that the definition of a norm is quite loose. It's a function with rather logical and weak constraints. Let's take a look at the example of a non-Euclidean norm. The simplest and best known, Manhattan norm, which is the sum of absolute values of x and y. Try to check that this function satisfies all properties of the norm. Let's now take a look at the set of vectors with Manhattan norm 1, that is, the unit circle in the Manhattan metric. Well, our circle is a square, non-standard but logical due to definition of this norm. We can construct a semi unit circle for any given norm, but consider the opposite. Imagine we have some kind of a simple closed curve on the plane. How can we check that this curve induces a norm that will have such a unit circle? Firstly, I'd like to note that the fact that the set of points must be such a curve is not something obvious. I suggest you trying to prove it yourself or read the proof. So, what restrictions on the curve should we set so that it induces a norm?
The first logical requirement.
Curve must contain origin. Indeed, origin must have a norm of a zero because of absolute homogeneity. And we are looking at a curve with norm 1. Another direct consequence of absolute homogeneity is a symmetry about the center. Just by setting alpha as a minus 1, we get the inverse point. Note that we've gotten quite a lot without using the triangle inequality. Guess it's time to find some requirement related to it. The figure enclosed in our curve must be convex. Convex means that any segment between two points inside the figure lies completely inside the figure. So, how could we prove that? Consider two points and corresponding vectors. How could we find all vectors on a segment between these points? Each vector on the segment is a linear combination of the initial vectors, with the lambda lying between 0 and 1 to stay within the segment. Then, it's not difficult to prove the convexity requirement. Inside the figure, in our case, means has norm at most 1. Then it's enough to choose two vectors, take vectors on the segment between their ends, and, using homogeneity and triangle inequality, get that the new vector will also have norm at most 1. So, unfortunately, we can't have a norm with the unit circle being a heart. Now, it will be easier for us to understand a very important property of norms on the plane. They are all equivalent. That is, for any pair of norms p and q, their constants little m and big m, such that q is bounded by p above and below with these constants. In the context of our union circle, this can be explained by the fact that we can always make our circle big or small enough, which is precisely what the application of the constants means. But I'd like to note that when we enlarge our circle, we actually make our norm smaller, because bigger values of x and y, after increasing the size of a union circle, we now have norm 1, rather than before. Let's try to find the constants that bound the Manhattan norm to the Euclidean norm. Since the square is fully inside the circle, we can say that the Manhattan norm is always greater than Euclidean. But because we can see that there are points where circles intersect, we can say that little m is 1. And with some middle school math, we can find that big M is actually root of 2. That means if we were to find overall Manhattan distance and give it as an answer, our relative error would be root of 2. That is about 40%. which is quite cool. But even cooler, we can divide our inequality by 2 to the 1/4. Now we have more symmetric bounds. So if we were to find overall Manhattan distance and return it divided by 2 to the 1/4, our relative error will also be 2 to the 1/4, which is about 19%.
In spite of this, let's try to solve this problem with the Manhattan distance.
So, how to find overall Manhattan distance between points faster than n squared? Actually, it's quite easy. Note that we can search for the total distance separately by x coordinate and by y. Let's try to calculate the total distance along the x-axis. To do this, note that x from the point xy will be included in the final distance a times with a plus sign and b times with a minus sign, where a is the number of points with a coordinate less than x, and b is the number of points with a coordinate greater than x. Then the solution is incredibly simple. It's enough to sort all the points by the x-coordinate, which can be done in big O of n log n, go from left to right and add the next x to the final sum with a coefficient that is easy to calculate. Similarly, we can calculate the answer for y and therefore calculate the total distance. Let's take a closer look at the Manhattan distance as a function of the Euclidean distance. Suppose we have some line segment on the plane. Then the Manhattan distance is the sum of the projections on the x-axis and y-axis, which is expressed by a rather simple function of the angle to the x-axis and the length of the segment itself. Let's look at the graph of the path that accounts for the projections. We can see that this function lies between 1 and 1.4, which has already been shown a little earlier. But let's think about the problem within this graph. We'd like it to be as gentle as possible, meaning the ratio of the maximum value to the minimum value should be as close to 1 as possible. Then we could estimate the distance of the vector itself quite well, namely with the accuracy of the root of the ratio of the maximum value of the function to the minimum value minus 1.
Why such a strange error? Because of the same trick as with 2 to the 1/4. We want symmetric bounds to improve precision, so we should divide our inequality by root of the product of our constants.
But how would we make the graph of the function more gentle? How could we make the Manhattan distance smoother? As noted, the Manhattan distance is the sum of projections on two axes. But why just two? Can we make it more? We can. Let's add two more lines to divide the plane into 8 equal angles and express the resulting sum of projections through the length of the segment and the angle to the x-axis. We can see that the projections on the new lines are still easily expressed through the angle. Again, paying attention to the graph, we can see that the final accuracy has improved, but it's still not good enough. But the way to the solution is already clear. We can just increase the number of lines for projections and wait until the precision is good enough.
Here I would like to note that what we actually are doing is making our distance less affected by the angle. We could think of it like the more lines we have, the more information about the angle we can get. Therefore, we can better estimate actual Euclidean distance that is not affected by the angle at all. And here is how our norm looks like in terms of unit circle. As Manhattan norm produces square, our current norm produces 16-sided polygon. It's much closer to a circle, therefore our estimation with this norm is better. Yet it consists of line segments. This is why we can compute it much faster.
As you can see, we only need 8 lines for 1% precision. Only the finishing touches remain. For the solution itself, it will be enough to project all our points on all the lines, and just like in Manhattan distance, to get the result along each of the lines, and then, using the maximum and minimum values of the function of the angle, choose the coefficient by which we will divide it. Well, it's time to implement the solution. It doesn't depend on randomness in any way, so we are sure of it. The final complexity of the solution is big O of m n log n, where m is the number of lines onto which we project. That is, in our case, 8. Expected positive result. Such an interesting problem was at the qualifying stage of the ACPC. Kudos to the author of the problem, Maxim Ahmedov, and thanks for watching.